Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Choose Us. Youth climate strike demands solutions and actions now.
You say you love your children above all else, and yet you are stealing their future in front of their very eyes.
What do we want?
Climate justice!
What do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Climate justice!
What do we want it?
Now! Oh!
Yeah! We recognize that striking from school is not going to solve the climate crisis, but it's going to enable the political mechanisms that can.
I, along with the rest of the youth movement, are demanding justice.
Your generation is rightly and justly demanding a better world.
Our voices are powerful. They make a difference. They matter. Real change can come from young people standing up for what they believe in.
I wouldn't be organizing, and I wouldn't be doing this, and I wouldn't be sacrificing so much if it weren't so urgent.
It is a magnificent thing to be alive in a moment that matters so much. This earth, our home, is calling for us to be bold.
We now need to change practically everything. We now need a whole new way of thinking.
We strike today, but we vote tomorrow.
And we need you because this movement requires everyone.
Please welcome Ethical Culture Society leader, Dr. Ann Clayson.
Good evening, and welcome to the meeting house of the New York Society for Ethical Culture. Ours is a community founded in 1876 that puts ethics at the center of our lives and seeks, in partnership with others, to make our world a place where everyone can realize their hopes and dreams. There is much that can divide us if we allow it, but much more that can bring us together when we open our hearts and our minds. We invite everyone to join us on the common ground of ethics. Our guiding principles are to attribute worth and dignity to every human being, to act in ways that elicit the goodness in others and thereby in ourselves, and to cherish our shared home, Mother Earth. I am delighted to be welcoming back to our ethical culture home several of our speakers this evening. This is indeed the place where people come to join others on the common ground of ethics and where they return time and time again. So just to give you an idea, our opening speaker gave one of his early slide presentations here in 1991. The young climate leaders you'll be hearing from have spent much of the last 2 months here organizing for Friday's amazing and historic strike. This program's sponsor spent memorable time here during his high school years, participating in ethical youth groups. Yes, right here. Our Drawdown presenter helped kick off Climate Week last year right here in this auditorium. And our council member has spoken here before as well. And I also want to give a shout out to many of you students who are here, including the class of one of our board members, Steve. So thank you to all the students who are here. We are so very grateful to be sharing our home with all of you, some of you who are coming back and some of you who are here the first time. We hope that this will be your home away from home, especially making ethics the center of your lives. And now, to begin our program, I have been given the honor of introducing someone who really needs no introduction. Before he became our 45th Vice President in 1993, Al Gore was a dedicated environmentalist. His book, Earth in the Balance, came out in 1992. Since that time, his efforts to inform the world about climate change has been the stuff of legend, but it's very, very real. His Academy Award-winning documentary, An Inconvenient Truth, has informed and inspired millions, including many young environmental activist leaders today. He was awarded the Nobel Prize, Peace Prize, along with the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in 2007, and founded the Climate Reality Project, which has trained thousands of leaders to spread the word. Please welcome one of my ethical heroes, the chairman of the Climate Reality Project and former vice president of the United States, Al Gore.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Anne. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Ann Clayson. I really appreciate that very generous introduction. And I remember coming here way back in 1991. I'm here with my daughter, Corinna Gore, who's chairman of the Center for Earth Ethics. And she and I just came from the China-California Joint Consortium. The reason I bring it up is, you mentioned my book, Earth in the Balance, 1991. I just ran into the guy who translated that into Chinese in 1991. So there are a lot of memories being awakened for me here. I want to acknowledge Dr. Katharine Wilkinson, and I will introduce her by way of a video a little bit later. I'm looking forward to the panel. It's a main event for me here. But I also want to acknowledge Henk Rogers with Blue Planet Alliance, who is a sponsor of this event. And Henk and I have known each other for quite a while, and I've been in his home in Hawaii doing an event for Senator Brian Schatz of Hawaii. And I want to acknowledge a really terrific member, very climate-effective member of the city council, Costa Constantinides. And there he is, right here. Thank you. Almost mangled your name, Costas, but Costas Constantinides, I want to say it correctly because he does wonderful work on climate. So I'm going to make a few brief remarks, and then I'm going to introduce a panel of young people who are inspiring to me and perhaps to many of you as well, I'm betting that. I don't know what to say that you don't already know. I've spent the day at the United Nations at the UN Climate Summit. The basics are pretty simple at this point. This crisis is a threat to the future of humanity. It is now seriously damaging and degrading the conditions that gave rise to the flourishing of human beings. And it's difficult for any of us to wrap our minds around the magnitude and scale and seriousness of this threat. It's planetary. It takes place over time periods that we're not usually comfortable dealing with. We have quadrupled human population in less than a century, and so that alone has magnified our impact on the planet. Although there is good news there, because we are seeing a success story unfold in slow motion with the stabilizing of population. Not yet, but we're on that trajectory now by educating girls and empowering women and making fertility management ubiquitously available and reducing child mortality more. When all four of those factors are present, populations change from one equilibrium state to another. The first is characterized by high death rates and high birth rates and large families. But then it changes. When you have those four factors present, you move to a new one with low death rates and low birth rates and small families. The fourth factor is important among all of them. Reduced child mortality gives parents the confidence that their children will survive. But in any case, we've expanded our population fourfold. Our technologies are infinitely more powerful than those available to our grandparents and great-grandparents. And the third factor that has caused this radical dysfunction in the relationship between humanity and the Earth's ecological system is our way of thinking, which is characterized in part by short-term thinking. We've all heard what comes off as a cliche sometimes. It's actually a true story about the Haudenosaunee people, indigenous people from northern New York and Quebec, who said decisions should be made with the seventh generation in the future in mind. We often have decisions made with the next quarterly report in mind, or the next overnight public opinion poll, or the next weekly TV rating, and that's not adequate. And our way of thinking is also inadequate because we ignore some of the most valuable things in life. If it doesn't come with a price tag attached, if it's not easily monetized and financialized, we often ignore it. And so the economists use this word externalities, you've all heard it. And so we ignore the pollution, ignore the depletion of natural resources, ignore rising inequality, which is one of the factors fueling this horrific wave of populist authoritarianism, a preference for strongman politics instead of trusting in ourselves and the self-governance and the constitutional representative democracy that is the birthright of every person who lives here in the United States of America, a system of self-governance that taps into the wisdom of crowds that has been imitated by others and is now in jeopardy. So we still get 80% of our energy from fossil fuels, and we're still putting more than 140 million tons each day of man-made heat-trapping pollution into the sky. And the sky's a thin shell, as you know, the part that matters, the part we can breathe, and the part where the greenhouse gases accumulate. And the accumulated amount now traps as much energy as would be released by 500,000 first generation atomic bombs exploding every day, and we see the consequences, and I'm not going to run through them because you know them. But there is good news, not enough of it, but we have seen wonderful advances in the production of energy from sunlight and from wind. And 5 years ago, the year before the Paris Agreement, electricity from the sun and the wind was cheaper than electricity from new fossil fuel plants in 1% of the world. Today, 5 years later, it's cheaper in 2/3 of the world compared to new fossil fuel plants. And 5 years from now, it will be cheaper in 100% of the world, and already existing fossil fuel plants are being closed. Already electric vehicles are expanding. Already farmers are leading the way toward regenerative agriculture. Already there is movement to plant more trees. Ethiopia just planted 353 million trees in 12 hours. Thank you, Ethiopia. But one of the many dangers we face that some of the most eloquent of the young people, you're about to hear from them, have warned us against is false hope and sinking into hope that is intoxicating but not entirely real in the sense that it's not nearly enough. And the truth is that all of these hopeful signs, some of which I've just described, are not nearly enough to prevent catastrophe. We need more. And we need changes in policies. We need to stop subsidizing fossil fuel burning. We need to put a price on carbon and start discouraging these activities. And there's a long list of these policies, and I'm not going to take your time to go through them, but the reason our policies are wrong is we have the wrong policy makers. The stakes are unbelievably high, but this is the life and death battle for this generation. This is Thermopylae. This is Agincourt. This is Lexington and Concord and Trafalgar and Dunkirk and the Battle of the Bulge and Pearl Harbor and September 11th. At such times, young people will go out and volunteer to put their lives on the line. Is it really too much to ask that politicians do what they already know is the right thing to do anyway and say no to the special interests that have been buying their judgment and votes? Okay, enough from me. I usually close my remarks by pointing out that we still do have the ability to avoid the civilization-ending consequences if we act quickly. And we can act quickly if we have the requisite political will. And political will, always remember, is itself a renewable resource. And we must renew it. Okay, I'm looking forward to the highlight of this event. Thank you for letting me say a few words that were on my mind and heart. I'm going to introduce these young people and ask them to come up here on stage. I'm going to take the far seat over there, if I'm not mistaken. Is that the close-in seat? Okay, thank you. Like I was saying, I'm going to take the close-in seat here. First of all, I want to introduce to the stage Jamie Margolin, who is a climate reality leader and is the founder of Zero Hour. Jamie is 17 years old, a Colombian-American writer, a community organizer, activist, public speaker. She is the founder and co-executive director of Zero Hour that led the very first youth climate march in Washington, D.C. and 25-plus cities all around the world during the summer of 2018. She's also one of the plaintiffs
in our Children's Trust Youth versus the government of Washington. She puts an emphasis on climate justice, and I was so happy when she came to the Climate Reality Project's training in Seattle, near where she lives. Next, I want to introduce to you Naomi Hollard, founder of Sunrise Columbia. Well, I love the Sunrise movement. Naomi is a Franco-Caribbean organizer based in Philadelphia. She graduated from this year from Columbia, majoring in neuroscience and behavior, and she's led research on these issues, and she was moved by the Sunrise Movement's powerful sit-in in November of 2018. Y'all remember that, after the blue wave produced a Democratic majority, and people said, oh, no, that's just the beginning of this. We've got to hold their feet to the fire, and that was really a turning point moment. And she started organizing through the Sunrise Movement. She's organized office visits for the Green New Deal, founded Sunrise Columbia, recruited over 300 members. Okay, next I want to introduce Sophie Anderson. Hi, Sophie. Sophie is a co-national coordinator for Extinction Rebellion, XR. Extinction Rebellion Youth US, launched in April 2019, has rapidly spread to over 50 locations across the country. You all know what the Extinction Rebellion is and what it is doing, and we really appreciate you very much, Sophie. All right, next, I want to bring to the stage Shia Bastida. Shia is the organizer of Fridays for Future and Earth Guardians, teenage activist based here in the city, and one of the lead organizers for the climate strike movement called Fridays for Future. She mobilized 600 students in March of this year from her school, and her principal got pretty upset when there were several such walkouts by 600 people until they all got amnesty and from the school district, and the principal didn't get marked down for it. But Bastida was born and raised in Mexico as part of the Otomi Toltec indigenous peoples, and her parents, Mindahi and Geraldine, are here. I happen to know them and love them. Bastida launched a youth activism training program and has done wonderful work, and was invited last year to the United Nations World Urban Forum to talk about indigenous issues. And so thank you, Shia. Next, I want to bring Alexandria Villaseñor. Alexandria is also a climate reality leader and went through the training in Minneapolis. Is that right?
That is.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm good. Really glad to see you again. So, a seventh grader, frustrated by the lack of progress on climate in Poland and inspired by Greta Thunberg, she became a national and international organizer for the first ever global youth climate strike. And by the way, Alexandria sat outside the United Nations alone by herself every Friday for weeks and weeks and weeks, and we admire that. All right, I'm going to start with you, Jamie. Tell us a little bit more about Zero Hour. I remember when it first came off, I was so proud. I said, I remember her from the climate reality training.
Yeah.
And I was tweeting about it. And
yes, you were.
And patting you on the back and all that. But how did it start and what is it?
So Zero Hour is a youth climate justice movement that really started the summer of 2017. So just a little background, I've been a community organizer since I was 14, a freshman in high school, and now I've come full circle and I'm 17 and I'm a senior in high school. So ever since my freshman year, I've been organizing and mobilizing my local community of Seattle for climate action. But people were not listening to us. There was not the same level of media attention or anything like that for young activists. It wasn't cool. To be a young climate activist, it was just kind of like me and a few other weirdos running around doing our thing around Olympia, just knocking on politicians' doors, trying to get some common sense legislation passed. And I was like, there has to be something bigger than this. And so after Hurricane Maria devastated Puerto Rico, and there are these wildfires in southern Canada that blew over Seattle, and It was hard to breathe, even for me, who is able-bodied and has no respiratory illnesses. So that was kind of the final straw. And so I posted on social media, I'm going to start a youth climate march. Who's with me? And I got a few messages from young people around the country who were. And we came together, and over the course of a year, from July of 2017 to July of 2018, we organized, we mobilized, and we built nonstop, and culminated in the youth climate marches on July 21st of 2018 in Washington, D.C. and 25 cities around the world. And not only did we march, but we also brought forth a specific platform of demands to our leaders. We had a lobby day on Capitol Hill the day before, demanding exactly what we, the youth, needed in order to have a livable future. Not what was politically feasible, not what was, you know, the compromise, you know, the United Nations at one point said 2 degrees Celsius and all these compromises, but actual, tangible, real solutions that we needed. And we brought them to our leaders, and then we marched for them. And then we've been just working ever since. And then about a month later, after the youth climate marches, Greta Thunberg started her school strike. And so then the momentum after that, it was like dominoes, like the momentum of the youth climate movement just exploded. Another thing that I'd like to emphasize is that Zero Hour, we focus on addressing the root systems of oppression that caused the climate crisis in the first place. So the climate crisis is mostly the result of, you can break it down to four things. At the root of it is colonialism and the idea that everything is for extraction, that everything is ours to take. And I always say that the climate crisis started in 1492, when Columbus sailed the ocean blue or whatever crap we're taught in school about that. Unregulated capitalism, the way that the need for constant growth, the need for constant accumulation, this fantasy of constant growth, that cannot be sustained, and then patriarchy and racism. So those are the root systems of oppression that caused it in the first place. And you know, Einstein defined insanity as trying to solve an issue with the same thinking that caused it. But yet, here we find ourselves trying to solve the climate crisis with the same colonial, consumeristic, extractive methods that caused it. And so we have to think outside the box. And so that's really what Zero Hour does with our mobilizations and our events.
Have you So you've given some thought to this? So Naomi, simple question. What was it like to be on CNN's town hall on climate?
I mean, it doesn't start there. I think to explain what it was like sitting in this room that was like so well lit, the lighting was amazing. We all looked beautiful in that room. But it was you had like Wolf Blitzer in the front. It was surreal being there. But when I was sitting there, I was thinking about like what had brought me to that position in the first place. I mean, this whole room was full of all these really excited people to end the climate crisis. And it made me think about your documentary that I watched when I was 8 years old. And I remembered seeing the graphs of like the CO2 emissions going up and then like the correlated global temperature rises. And like, to be honest, it's kind of boring a little bit, but like, I understood. No,
I was.
No, you were fantastic,
okay.
But the graphs were boring.
I just wanted clarification on that.
But what I do remember as my 8-year-old self is that I was scared. I was scared about the climate crisis. I remembered seeing, you said that there would be these massive hurricanes, these massive wildfires, this massive destruction, and I, as a little 8-year-old, could just imagine it in my front door. I could imagine my house on fire. I was very scared. And the first time that the climate crisis hit me, I'm from Wisconsin, by the way, I was raised in Wisconsin, was in 2010 when we had one of the worst droughts of Wisconsin history. Yeah. And I remember I actually didn't live far from cornfields, you know, it's Wisconsin. And I would just see the corn shriveling, the grass was brown, the trees, I didn't even know the trees could die in drought.
Yeah.
And I just trusted though, I saw this destruction, but I trusted that my leadership and that our politicians and our leaders would do something about
this.
But it wasn't until 2017, I was sitting in my room scrolling through on my computer and I saw a hurricane was gonna hit my island of Guadeloupe. Mm. It wasn't until then that I realized that I needed to do something and that I needed to fight. And so I actually was gonna be a neuroscience major. I was gonna be a professor in neuroscience and I was in my third year at Columbia. Like that, I had done research. I was prepared to go to get my PhD, but I switched it all because I wanted to take action to save my future and save the future of the people I loved. And to push my leaders to do something. And so as I sat in that room in the climate town hall, I like couldn't believe that me having wanted to change this world to make it a better place, to get our leaders to do something, that I was here in front of the world, I was gonna be speaking in front of millions and millions of people. And it made me believe in the change. And I know for a fact that if we come together, we continue the climate strikes, we continue fighting, we will get that change.
Good for you. Good for you. Great. So, Sophie, I've watched Extinction Rebellion grow so quickly, and in just 5 months, spread to 50 different locations. What do you think is the secret to that rapid growth of XR Youth?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, thank you, Mr. Vice President, for being here. I really appreciate it. It's an honor to be here with these amazing young women, some of which are my really great friends. So I'm very excited to be here. Second, I apologize that my voice is like this, and that all of you have to listen to me in this condition.
You're fine.
But I wouldn't have to be like this if people took action. So
please
do that. Anyway, to answer your question, we've seen amazing growth over the last 5 months since we launched XR Youth US. And it's been a joy to be a part of. And I think to break it down, it comes down to like three main points. The first of which is we were able to tap into an amazing network that Extinction Rebellion had already created. Extinction Rebellion was launched in the UK last November when they declared open rebellion against the British government. And that's kind of what first struck me about XR, was kind of how blunt they were about the issue.
Yep.
How they had climate emergency on a red banner, and that visually was just something I had never seen before. So we were able to use this messaging that's very consistent and tap into that and bring it to the US and tweak it because the US message is different, but really kind of build off of that community. The second, I think, is our generation has really been able to utilize social media in a way that helps us. And so we have started an Instagram account, and we started a Twitter account, and people started following us, and they started listening to what we were doing, and they wanted to join. And we were able to use the resources that we had created to very quickly set up local groups all across the country. And then the third, I think, is because we're nonpartisan. Because we recognize that in order to solve the climate crisis, we need to take political action, but we need everybody to join us in that fight. So we support political action, but not based on its party, based on what it consists of.
Yeah, well, thank you so much.
Yeah,
that's
thank
you. Really well said. Shia, one of the reasons so many families from Central America and from the part of Mexico that your family is from have been moving northward is because of the climate crisis. I know you were very young when you moved, but what is it like for the families in a region that is hit by climate-related drought and weather disruptions of various kinds? Could you share that experience?
Hi, everyone. So I think that for us,
as young people, the climate crisis is not something that is going to happen in 100 years anymore. It's something that is happening to us. It's something that we are seeing happen all around the world. And to live in a world that is burning, melting, and just getting destroyed by hurricanes is not something that is okay. And when that hits your home, that's when it hurts the most. And so in 2015, I was born and raised in Mexico. In 2015, my town was hit by, before drought, it was hit by rain, a lot of rain. And that not only caused the street to flood, but it also caused the river that is right next to, that is polluted by all the factories that are near there, to overflow. And so it's not only seeing how the climate crisis is the results in, you know, a lot of natural disasters, but it also results in health issues and contamination and everything that comes from us being dependent on fossil fuels and the fossil fuel industry. And, you know, my parents had always done amazing work on trying to address these issues wherever they are. And I know that when we were in Mexico, they were trying to clean the river. They were trying to clean the lake that we have, because that is our source of life. Mm. I grew up in a context where I was taught, you know, the earth takes care of you, you have to take care of the earth. Water is life, fire is life, earth is life, air is life, but we need balance in all of those. When there is not balance, everything goes crazy, and when we are in an economic system that only strives for linear upward growth, then we're not gonna get anywhere. Mm. We need to bring back the cycles of life that we have lost. And that's why I really like to echo what Jamie says about, you know, colonialism and how extractive that has been. Because we have seen the climate movement grow exponentially in recent months. Mm-hmm. But the climate movement didn't start with us. It didn't start 60 years ago when the environmental movement, as we know it today, started. Mm-hmm. The climate movement has always been here, and it's indigenous people protecting the earth because that's their way of life. And I just, you know, also my parents had the amazing opportunity to come to New York City to work with your daughter, Karina Gore, in the Center for Earth Ethics. And for me, the Center for Earth Ethics, I've never really thought about it until I thought about earth ethics and what that encompasses. Mm. Because we need to switch our mindset. If we switch our energy source to renewable energy, and we don't switch our mindset, then nothing is gonna change. Mm-hmm. We need to switch our mindset to a mindset of, we want love and we want peace into this movement. We want to take care of everyone. We don't want to be in competition, but collaboration. Mm. And so I didn't become a climate activist until very recently when, you know, as the climate crisis gets worse, and I learned this from Alexandria's philosophy, you are going to have more activism because the earth is waking us up and the earth is shaking and it's making us tell the adults, stop. Mm. Take a moment, breathe, realize what we are going through. It's very hard. I know that climate anxiety wasn't a term before recent years, and now to hear that almost every week is not okay. Mm. And so it's about bringing balance back, it's about bringing our ideals back, and it's about bringing ethics into the work we do.
Wonderfully said. Woo! Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Alexandria, I'm just curious what it was like for you emotionally and mentally sitting there by yourself every Friday for so many weeks. Did you have a sign with you explaining what you were doing?
Yes, so I've been on climate strike every Friday in front of the United Nations headquarters for the past 41 weeks. So I've
How many weeks?
41 weeks. So So I had been out striking in wind, rain, sleet, the polar vortex, and throughout summer I had been through heat waves. And so really, the movement continued to grow, though. Every single Friday, you'd see more and more students getting out onto the streets and protesting. And it was very powerful, especially on September 20th, where 4 million students internationally went on school strike for climate. And so as the community of activists continues to grow, it's very empowering to see. And I also think that with the climate crisis and more students are getting involved, you'll see more students starting to find ways to take action in different categories and trying to find different ways to get action from world leaders. So for example, today, this morning, I went to the United Nations, and myself, Greta Thunberg, and 14 children from all around the world, and I would tell you all their names, but I can't remember them off the top of my head.
That's okay.
So I recommend you go to Children vs. Climate Crisis. .org to find out all of their names. And so we filed a complaint to the Committee on the Rights of the Child stating that our rights are being violated all over the world. And so all of us children who are doing this have been impacted by the climate crisis. And so we feel as if world leaders have failed in doing their job. And so now we have to take them to court. And so I first got involved in climate activism because I was visiting family back in Northern California when the Paradise Fire broke out.
Wow.
And so my hometown was so close to Paradise, we had gotten a lot of the smoke because it became the worst wildfire in California history. And the smoke would be seeping into my house. I had to roll up wet towels and put them under windows and doors. And since I have asthma, it kept inflaming my asthma and making me nauseous. And I remember being there too, these face masks were being handed out to keep you from inhaling the smoke. But what happened is those face masks didn't keep out the particles that were actually harmful. So that was just the first thing I noticed about how we are not prepared for the effects of the climate crisis and how to protect ourselves. And so once I'd gotten back to New York City because my family had to send me back early, I started to research wildfires. And that's how I started to see the connection between wildfires and the climate crisis. And so seeing Greta Thunberg at COP24 was really what made me feel like I knew what I had to do to make my voice heard. But now with this complaint, it's another way of making our voices heard and making sure that world leaders listen to the science. But the most important thing about the complaint too is even though there's 16 children in it, it's in solidarity with children all around the world who are experiencing the effects of the climate crisis. And so we want to empower those children to go out and make their voices heard too.
Good luck with your lawsuit. That's great. I'll just interject briefly. I was at the UN myself today, and I was watching and listening as Greta Thunberg gave her speech. And I was so deeply moved by it. I've heard several of her commentaries and speeches. This, for me, was the most powerful one of all. And I listened to the five of you, and you guys are all so powerful too in what you're saying. And I'm just so grateful to you. And I know your fight has just begun, and there's so much more to do. But Jamie, what have you found to be the most powerful ways to communicate to people that inspire them to take action?
So the most powerful ways to communicate to people, I feel like it changes. Like she was saying about graphs being boring. So right now, if I show someone, for example, a chart of CO2, now thanks to your work, that it's kind of become mostly common knowledge of like the way the CO2 is going, the greenhouse gas effects, that's mostly common knowledge now. The way that you mobilize people to act, I feel like climate denial is not really the biggest problem. It's climate apathy, because people will know what's happening, but they'll be like, oh yeah, actually with Generation Z, it's kind of weird. Most of our, we kind of have a, oh yeah, we're all gonna die, it's fine. We'll just enjoy the ride down. Like, it's not a denial of what's happening, it's just nihilism. And so there's like a weird—
Denialism?
Denialism?
I didn't make that up, by the way.
Yeah, because it's like a nihilism of like, there's nothing we can do. And so what you use to communicate that is not more graphs and science, because people know that, but you use stories, specifically stories like Xie's story about like her family. It's one thing if it's like statistics of like this many people died, but it's another thing if you show the actual story of like the people that died. They're not just numbers.
So you can connect to.
You have to connect like human to human. Like ever since the dawn of time, people have been gathering around fires, telling stories. Mm-hmm. And so the way you move people is with the way that our brains are wired to work in, which is through stories. Another way is, I think mass mobilizations, a lot of people mistake the mass mobilization as the end goal, but in reality, it's the entry point. So a lot of the times, the strikers there are not the organizers. They're not. There's not like 250,000 climate justice organizers in New York City. That's the amount of people that striked yesterday. But those are the amount of people who cared enough to come out in the sun. And a great way to also communicate and get people involved and inspired is with these events that are exciting, that are fun, that have music, that have art, and bring them into it. And then through there are entryways and entry points into the movement. The movement is not something that is only communicated through science. Well, I'm not dissing science here because it's very important, but what I'm saying is that everyone is needed. Artists, musicians, actors, dancers, everyone can use their own skills and talents to communicate. Because I think, for example, like art is so important because art is the universal language of the world. And not everyone can understand, you know, a specific piece of writing, but if there's a mural of like the destruction that is happening because of the climate crisis, everyone kind of knows what's happening, and no matter where you're from around the world, you can see. And so people often ask me, what is like the one best way to take action? What is the one best way? And I think that mindset of just the one best way is very skewed, because it comes from that idea of just like, what's the best top-down solution I can just enforce and push on everyone, which is that colonial mindset again. It's not about what one thing can inspire people, what one thing is the solution. It's about literally doing everything at every angle. So we have to attack this crisis at every angle, through the legal angle, through the legislative angle, through mobilizations, through education, and the same goes with education of that. We have to use science, we have to use art, we have to use music, we have to use everything. Mm-hmm. And so this should not be a one or the other. This is just a Hail Mary last approach, which is really what it is, of just literally throwing everything you can at it, because because something's bound to stick.
Well, very good. Well said. I could listen to you all day. Naomi, tell me about the experience. You train future activists, right?
Yep.
You recruit them and then train them.
Yeah.
What's that like?
Oh man, it's like this. You get rooms full of people and you teach them kind of what's the best way to go about getting this change that we need to see. And I think part of doing these trainings, it's so empowering for the people that are there. I mean, one thing, so as a trainer, I actually, a lot of what we train is in, like, we talk about political alignments. I don't know, do people know about political alignments? Yeah, okay, generally, no, okay. Well, we talk about political alignments and how the fact that, like, we've been able to change how we see the world before. How we lived in an era during the New Deal era, this era before when we didn't have minimum wage, we didn't have a social security, we didn't have all of these things that we take for granted today. Mm. And in these trainings, we talk about this, and we talk about what got them there. What got them to make this massive change that people were like, this is absolutely impossible, you can't possibly do this. And the reality is that, yes, you had FDR, the president, during the Great Depression, World War II there, pushing for these things, for these changes. But most importantly, you had millions and millions of people striking on the streets in Flint, Michigan, and all over the country, demanding for the right of like having a good life. And that is what we teach. We talk about the power of mass non-cooperation in these trainings. Mm. And what we know today is that if enough people take to the streets and they're united in this fight, then we can get the change that we want to see in the world. Mm. And as you know, we believe that the Green New Deal is the plan, the only plan at the scale of the climate crisis. That's why it's called the Green New Deal, right? Mm. We're in the same era of thinking that what is going to be in our future? What is lying in the future? We have not, you know, people have work jobs and they can't feed their family. We have people drinking poisonous water that's giving them cancer and killing them. Yeah. You see people breathing dangerous air. This is the future that we live in. We also live in an unstable climate because of climate change. Mm. So we come together, right? This is what I teach at the trainings. We come together. We get to the streets, we strike, 250,000, 350,000 of us, we're gonna get millions and millions and millions. And most importantly, we're gonna unite behind with our politicians to fight for the common goal. And the common, and right now, the Green New Deal is the only plan at the scale of the climate crisis. Mm-hmm. So.
Good for you.
I might wanna add to that real quick when you were talking about before. You were talking about eras. And so I just wanna add real quick, this was announced when I testified before Congress a few days ago about this, but we, with Sunrise Movement, Zero Hour, and many different organizations are bringing about, it's not just about the Green New Deal legislation, it's about the mindset, it's about the culture. There were different eras in American history that we remember, you know, like the Reagan era and Reaganomics and all that stuff that screwed us over, and so now it's time for, trickle down doesn't work, and now it's time for a new era. So we're bringing about the era of the Green New Deal, because what is going to be the era that people look back in history books when we have solved this? What is the era called? And it's not about the legislation, it's about the values. So we're bringing about the era of the Green New Deal, and we say that we are not Generation Z because we refuse to be the last letter of the alphabet. Mm-hmm. We are Generation GND, yep. Generation Green New Deal.
Generation Green New Deal! Hey! Absolutely.
So, if I could just interject one word of historical context here from my own experience. Many decades ago, in addition to working on the climate crisis, there was a time when I worked really hard on nuclear arms control. And there was a period when there would, I'm about to ask you, Sophie, about climate anxiety because you've spoken about that. But then candidate Ronald Reagan talked about the evil empire back when the Soviet Union still existed and promised to restart the nuclear arms race. I mean, I'm simplifying it a little bit, but that's what people heard him saying, build a lot more nuclear armed missiles. And people got worried about it. And that anxiety led, among other things, to the emergence of something called the nuclear freeze, way before any of you were born, of course. But it bears a few things in common with the Green New Deal. It was bitterly criticized. People would pick at the details mm-hmm. of it, and they would say, well, you didn't do this right, and you said this wrong. And experts would say, well, that can't possibly work. That part of it has to be thrown out. But the nuclear freeze was easily understandable. It embodied values that people shared and believed in, and it attracted tremendous support across political and ideological lines. And it never was enacted as a detailed, specific piece of legislation, but it changed the way people thought, and it led to a completely new atmosphere for arms control negotiation. And back in those years, I was one of the ones at the beginning, because I'd tried to develop a lot of expertise on nuclear arms control, and I was one of the ones saying, no, that's not the right way to do it. And then I slowly came to realize, wait a minute, this is a mass movement based on some very understandable values, and that's how I see the Green New Deal, and I'm all for it. So Sophie, you have mentioned the subject of climate anxiety. Tell us your thoughts about that, and please include your thoughts on how to deal with it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think when it comes down to it, if you don't have climate anxiety, you're not paying attention.
There you go.
I mean, we're facing the sixth mass extinction. We're facing consequences right now. We're watching people die across the world, and our future is at stake, and all of that is terrifying. But I also think that especially at XR and across the youth movement, there's a real focus on regenerative culture and taking care of ourselves and avoiding burnout, because looking into the face of fear is really scary, but there are ways to kind of deal with that and channel that into the work that we're doing. And so, like I said, one of our principles at XR is kind of focusing on that and talking about how we're feeling and what we're going through and listening to each other and sharing sharing experiences, sharing stories, like Jamie said. I think a really good example of that is in New York City, we've been organizing as a part of a strike coalition. And there are 15 of us who are sitting in the audience on this core team. And those people who organized the strike, which had 311,000 people, I want to add, which is amazing. But I think that behind all of that is a lot of love and a lot of telling our stories to each other and sharing what's going on and making sure that everyone feels safe and checking in. Because organizing strikes is important, but taking care of ourselves is how we do that.
That's really well said. Yeah, very important. Thank you. And go ahead, sorry.
Yeah, no. But I think that, like I said, like while that's all scary, we don't let that stop us.
Right.
We're channeling all of that energy into the action that we're taking. Love and rage is kind of the slogan that XR uses, and I think that's very true. Because while rage comes in bursts, love is what sustains us.
Hmm. Woo! Indeed. It occurs to me that the five of you also have something that makes you lucky in spite of the anxiety and the terrible stakes involved here. All five of you have a passionate purpose in life and a mission that I'm sure feels like it justifies pouring all the energy you have into it. And I feel that way sometimes, and I've come to see that as a source of joy to have work that is really worthwhile. Shea, tell us more about your Earth Guardians and your mission to inspire others. Tell us about Earth Guardians.
So Earth Guardians is a group of indigenous activists, youth indigenous activists who are all over the world trying to bring back the teachings of indigenous groups and indigenous elders into the work that we do in climate justice advocacy. And that is because you cannot, as Jamie and others have said, you cannot solve the climate crisis with the same thinking that got us into this mess.
So like colonialism and the,
yeah,
and
that's the
yeah,
thinking,
legacy
that's
of thinking. Colonialism. Yeah.
And so the thinking that we have to go to is one of regeneration, one of, you know, grounding ourselves. And you know, every time we do ceremonies, every time we go out to nature, you remind yourself what you're fighting for. If you have a deep connection with the earth and a deep connection with what's around you, you're not gonna get burned out because that, you know, it revives you. And that's what's so special with the connection with the earth that a lot of us have lost. A lot of us as humans are so selfish that we are not caring about the climate crisis until it's affecting humans. We are not caring about the climate crisis until we are seeing our homes destroyed. But the homes of so many species and ecosystems and oceans have been already in the process of destruction. And so we have to connect with that and not let it scare us, but let it be something that inspires us to make change.
Mm-hmm.
And the last... Another point is that, you know, the climate crisis is so violent in nature. It's so violent because it brings destruction and it's about health issues, it's about economic instability, it's about farmers losing their land. And it is very scary. But because it's so violent, we have to tackle it with peace. We have to tackle it with love. And when we organize the strike, we do it in a way in which, you know, there is no hierarchy in our movement. There is no, I'm better than the other. There is no CEO. It's all of us working together, talking about it, making a decision, even if it means being on Zoom for 4 or 5 hours.
Mm.
Yes. And so, just like, we are doing the work in a way that is showing what we want the world to be. And we want the world to be conscious, we want the world to be awake, and we want the world to be connected.
Yeah, good for you. So, last question that we have time for. I could keep talking to these five for a long time. They're so inspiring and so great. Alexandria, you were awarded the Tribeca Film Festival's Disruptor Award this year. I guess so. Part of what you do is you focus on educating young people. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
It may seem like a mundane question, but some people overlook that. Why is education of young people so important?
Yes, so I'm the founder of an organization called Earth Uprising, and it does focus a lot on climate education. And through that, it can motivate young people to take direct action for their futures. And so what really made me realize that students needed to be educated on the climate crisis was after mobilizing now 3 global climate strikes, what I'd started to notice was that a lot of students weren't coming out and taking direct action, and they weren't getting involved because they didn't know the science. And they didn't understand why it was important to go out and take direct action for their future. And so really, Earth Uprising wants to educate young people on the climate crisis, on the basic facts, on how it's being caused. And it also intends to educate young people on past historical movements. So educate young people on movements in the past that really brought change. And so what's so important about this movement, the Fridays for Future movement, is that it is civil disobedience. It's that continued action every single Friday. And that is how we got OPEC to call the youth movement the number one threat to the oil industry.
Woo!
So it's that continuous civil disobedience that really makes a difference. And so once I noticed that students got educated on the crisis, then they wanted to go out and fight for their future, because when students know the science, then it's honestly mind-boggling that world leaders never did anything before. And so...
Yeah, for real.
Exactly, yeah. And so Earth Uprising is also a global organization, and so it focuses a lot on activists in developing countries in the global south, because we have a lot of ambassadors. And so when talking with them, and specifically in Nigeria, what we had discussed was how they are experiencing mass floods that sweep away their crops. They are experiencing an epidemic of meningitis and heat waves that make them have to sleep outside. But what they really needed was the education, because they didn't understand why it was happening to their community. And actually, a lot of Earth Uprising's global ambassadors were going to come to the first ever United Nations Youth Climate Summit. But what happened is a lot of the global activists got delayed or denied visas. And so it was very upsetting, but we were standing in solidarity with all of them and in spirit. And so just what's important about having activists in other countries involved is because they can really speak to what needs to happen in their country and the policies that need to be made, because they're experiencing the effects firsthand. And so that's what a lot of Earth Uprising focuses on.
So thank you very much. That's great. So we've run out of time for this, and I'm going to introduce Dr. Wilkinson, but wait until I say all their names one more time, but please join me in thanking Jamie Margolin, Naomi Hollard, Sophie Anderson, Shia Bastida, and Alexandria Villasenor. Thank you all very much.
Is this on?
You all should go on off. Thank you. Wonderful job. Great job. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Great work. Thank you.
Before you all sit down, when I say, what do we want? You say climate justice. What do we want?
Climate justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
What do we want?
Climate justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Good job.
Shut it down!
Wow.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, now for the next event here. We've just met 5 young women who are obviously extremely inspiring and are helping to lead the youth climate movement. And they also, by the way, represent a growing trend of female leadership globally. That is focused on repairing the earth while supporting a just transition for overlooked and exploited communities around the world. Women represent half the world's population, and more than that, really, and more than the numerical half, it's just impossible to fully describe, but women's voices are rising. And in the special climate issue that Time magazine put out this week, there's an article entitled The Women Who Will Save the World, and it featured, among others, our next presenter, Dr. Katharine Wilkinson. She is Vice President of Communication and Engagement at Project Drawdown, the research organization that identifies the most viable climate solutions and shares these findings with the world, and she was the lead writer of the New York Times bestseller, Drawdown. She holds a doctorate in geography and environment from Oxford, where she was a Rhodes Scholar, and she actually presented at the most recent climate reality trainings, and I'm very grateful for that. Last month, she co-hosted an outdoor retreat for women climate leaders, so the rest of this introduction will be in the form of a great video from that retreat. And then as the video ends, welcome Dr. Katharine Wilkinson to up on stage. Let's roll the video.
When I was young, I fell in love with this world.
I fell in love with the silence of the desert,
the smell of the earth after rain,
the plains of South Dakota. I fell in love with the way that the world holds us.
I am a climate scientist.
I am a Palestinian Texan.
An all-around general nerd.
I am an immigrant.
An advocate.
I'm a leader.
I am a black girl from the hood who's trying to change climate policy.
When I look around today,
I see a lot of brokenness.
Corruption. Divisions between the haves and the have-nots.
Living systems of the planet fraying.
And I feel worried about our future.
I feel grief.
I feel ashamed.
Really angry.
Heartbroken.
Numb. On good days, I feel courageous.
To me, the climate crisis
is an economic issue.
It's an immigration issue.
Spiritual issue.
A feminist issue.
A right now issue.
It's the ultimate intersectional justice issue.
I'm determined to be part of the solution because I want there to be children on this planet in 7 generations.
Because everyone has a role to play.
Because it's the right thing to do.
It's easy to imagine a future that is bleak.
I can also imagine transformation.
People rising in resilience.
100% clean energy farms that sequester carbon in their soil.
A world that is inclusive.
A future that works for all of us.
I am a woman.
I am a woman.
I am leading on climate.
We are leading on climate.
Join us.
Join us.
If you can't have your wolf pack with you, you should just bring them on video. I wanted to start with this because these are climate-wise women, and these are climate-wise women. And we're not doing this alone, we're doing this together. And there are so many generations of women boldly leading towards a climate-just future. I'm wearing my Angry Grannies for Climate Justice pin, which Mary Robinson gave me. For those who don't know, Mary was the first woman to be president of Ireland. She was the High Commissioner for Human Rights at the UN. She is remarkable. And while I am not technically an angry granny, I feel like one, and I feel like it gives just the permission one needs. So this is the time of truth tellers, of broken open hearts, of bold vision, of awake, aware, active participation in the community of life. This is the time of climate solutionaries. And at the heart of being a solutionary is immersing ourselves in humanity's collective wisdom about solutions. What are the practices, the tools, the technologies that we have at hand now, today, for transformation, for metamorphosis, for reshaping the world? What are the solutions for actually coming back into balance with our atmosphere and with the living systems of this planet? That's what our work at Project Drawdown is all about. And our head of research, Chad Frischman, is also in the house tonight. And our work is about surfacing, understanding, lifting up solutions, shining a light on what is actually possible in the face of a seemingly impossible challenge. And it's about empowering solutionaries who move those solutions forward. And so what I'd like to do is take you all on a little bit of a journey through the incredible mosaic of solutions that can actually move us towards drawdown. And at the risk of being incredibly boring, here is a graph. But this is an important graph. Drawdown is where we get our name, and it's our reason for being as an organization. It means the point in time when the rising concentration of greenhouse gases in our atmosphere stops its upward trajectory and actually begins to decline on a year-to-year basis. And this matters because this is the most critical turning point for life on Earth. And we have to reach it as quickly, as safely, and as equitably as possible. Another graph. I promise there are only a couple. But we have to start here, because these are the sectors of the global economy where greenhouse gases are coming from. We have to know where it starts. Nearly two-thirds of them are from fossil fuels in the form of carbon dioxide. But carbon dioxide also comes from land use, it comes from chemicals, and carbon dioxide isn't the only challenge. Methane, nitrous oxide, fluorinated gases. We have to address this whole suite of sources. And we have to think about this other half of the story, which is where greenhouse gases are going. Y'all, photosynthesis is amazing, and I think it's finally getting the attention that it deserves. Right? Yeah, some photosynthesis lovers. So land-based sinks, right, AKA nature, removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, incorporating it into biomass and soil. Ocean banks, ocean-based sinks, also removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. And our oceans are struggling because of that through biological and geochemical processes. So we have to think about the sinks as well, protecting and enhancing them. So if you want to reach drawdown, it's pretty simple. You have to think about both sides of the equation. Reduce and stop emissions of greenhouse gases going into the atmosphere, but also protect, enhance, and augment nature's ability to absorb greenhouse gases. We do not get to drawdown without both of these. So we've got to do all we can on both sources and sinks. And while the equation is deceptively simple, the solutions are many and varied. Solar, wind, Mr. Gore talked about, geothermal, microgrids, flexible grids, energy storage. This is the whole suite of solutions that helps us move towards 100% clean, renewable energy while we push back against electricity that's generated by burning fossil fuels. Do y'all know the first rooftop solar array went up in New York City in 1884? I think it's fair to say that it's waited long enough. Really critical solutions around food and agriculture, which again are, I think, beginning to get the attention that they deserve. This is about shifting to diets that are rich in plants with low or even no animal protein, reducing food waste and loss so that what we grow actually gets eaten. Those are top solutions that almost any individual and any institution can act on immediately and at no cost. I did not know that Lindsay Baker of WeWork would be in the house tonight, but WeWork simply decided to stop spending company money on meat. Done. And this sector is also about changing how we produce the food that we produce, to limit deforestation, to reduce the use of fertilizers, to minimize methane that comes from livestock and rice fields. Industry is a more complicated sector, and there are some really critical solutions here that we haven't cracked just yet. But there are a lot of others that we have. Things like addressing leaks and disposal of chemicals that are used in refrigeration and our cooling systems. Adopting better materials for construction and for the goods that we manufacture as we also move away from such a consumptive lifestyle in certain parts of the world. Moving away from take, use, trash, linear flows to circular economies, so that materials continue to move and we reclaim value from waste. The carpet that you can see here is made by a company called Interface, and the fibers of the carpet are from reclaimed fishing nets. So this is multi-solving for jobs, marine ecosystem conservation, circular economy, and also for this company, a product that people are really excited about. How do we keep the social good of mobility while moving it away from fossil fuels? Growing public and shared modes of transportation, designing cities for bikes and feet rather than cars, electrifying vehicles to transport people but also to transport goods. I haven't seen any scooters in New York City, but I live in Atlanta where scooters have gone everywhere, and it's been a reminder to me of actually how fast things can change in this space. Did you know we have at least 1.5 trillion square feet of existing building stock around the world? That means we have a huge task ahead of us to retrofit building with efficient heat pumps, LED lighting, smart thermostats, super efficient windows, green roofs, et cetera, because we need to enable all of our buildings to run on 100% renewable energy, and the more efficient they are, the better they can do that. And at the same time, we can get it right from the get-go with new buildings, designing and building them to be so efficient that they can actually produce more electricity than they consume over the course of a year. We talked about the two sides of the equation. Again, you sort of get the vibe of photosynthesis from all of this green. We have to protect and restore forests and peatlands. I don't know if y'all know about peatlands, but they are freaking amazing. Other ecosystems, we just have to let them do what they're good at doing, which among other things is sequestering carbon. And that means we have to ensure land sovereignty of indigenous communities, we're talking about 80% of the world's biodiversity on those lands as well. And agricultural practices that accumulate biomass and soil, regenerative farming, things like silvopasture. It is really just as simple as livestock and trees. But silvopasture systems sequester 5 to 10 more times than a regular treeless pasture. It's about multi-strata agroforestry. Solutions that help ensure we will be able to feed and nourish ourselves as climate impacts intensify. We can protect and restore coastal and marine ecosystems, and Project Drawdown is in the midst of doing a whole body of work around analyzing ocean solutions that's being led by Dr. Sarah Myrie. Wetlands and mangroves are carbon superstars. We can actually use regenerative farming practices in the ocean, which groups like Green Wave in the Northeast are pioneering. Kelp sequesters carbon faster than any plant on land. It's amazing. And this has come up a few times tonight. Climate solutions should always, always be designed to enhance equity and well-being of humans as well as nature. Otherwise, we think at Drawdown that they're not genuine solutions. And also, there are efforts that are primarily designed to advance gender equality, to advance education, to advance healthcare, that also have cascading benefits to the climate. When women and girls have access to high-quality, inclusive education and high-quality, voluntary, reproductive health care, both of which are fundamental rights, still out of reach of too many, and I say that as a woman who lives in Georgia, right? These are issues in our own backyard. But when girls and women are able to make choices about our lives and we're able to lead, those choices and that leadership turns out to be very, very good for the planet. Mary Robinson, you can clap at that. Mary has a wonderful podcast called Mothers of Invention, and the tagline of the podcast is, "Climate change is a man-made problem with feminist solutions." So we have this incredibly diverse toolbox. There are literally footholds of action for everyone, for every individual, every institution, multiple, in our homes, in our communities, in our cities, in our schools and workplaces, things we better damn well demand that business and government move on. They are here, they are now. They're ready to help us get to Drawdown. They're ready to help us build a climate-just future if we move them forward in ways that heal rather than deepen systemic injustices. So there's a question, I think, of we're not going to do it all. Nobody personally can do it all. But there's something here. There are probably many things here for everyone. And the question is, what sparks a fire in the belly for you? So this is where we are. We can feel the heat, the urgency. Do y'all know the work of the climate justice essayist, Mary Anais Hegler? Yeah. So Mary's work is amazing. You need to look her up on Twitter and Medium immediately. But Mary is a really big fan of the work of James Baldwin, which has sent me to be doing a bit of homework. And there was a fascinating conversation that James Baldwin and Margaret Mead had, talking about the future of democracy in a post-consumer world. And in the course of that conversation, he says, "We've made the world we're living in, and now we have to make it over." We could certainly do a lot of unpacking about who the we is that made the world we're living in. But the we that has to make it over is very clear. It is all of us. The task at hand is as simple and complicated as this. This is our work. This is the work of solutionaries, the work of transformation, the work of metamorphosis. Can't see you all very well, but if you'll do this with me, put one hand on your heart and one on your belly and turn to a neighbor and make eye contact with them and hold it. It is, you heard me choking up in that opening video. It is a magnificent thing to be alive in a moment that matters as much as this one does. It is a magnificent thing to be alive here on Earth right now and together. So let's go build the future. Thank you.
Hi, everyone, again. New York City Council's 22nd District is represented by a powerhouse for our movement. He has been committed to fighting the effects of climate change and keeping it from forever changing New York City's landscapes. As chair of the Environmental Protection Committee since 2015, he's making a profound difference for New Yorkers and setting the standard high for making the right policies take effect. In April of 2019, he led the effort to pass the Climate Mobilization Act, the largest carbon emissions reduction ever mandated by any city in the world. The eight-bill package tackled greenhouse gas emissions from large buildings, made the first step toward closing fossil fuel power plants, and required green roofs on new buildings. He's also on track to having solar-ready schools in his council district by 2020. And I also want to add, he is an amazing support to the youth climate movement here in New York City. So please put your hands together for Representative Costa.
Good evening, everyone. I'm not quite sure how I follow all of these amazing leaders this evening. I am still in awe of all of you. Every day I think about my son and the world that he'll inherit and the world that you're fighting for every day. And you give me hope. You truly do. So I want to thank Vice President Gore and Alexandria, who we've met before, and I'm inspired every time, and Zia and Jamie and Naomi. We miss you here in New York, and Sophie, for that enriching discussion and for your activism and your willingness to put yourselves on the line every single day for all of us. Thank you for leading, because I've heard it so many times today. The children are acting like adults, and the adults are acting like children. And thank you for being the adult in the room, because we absolutely have needed it. Like so many people have said tonight, it's all about you and the work that you do, and it's all for you. By the time you're become my age, which seems far away, you'll be the council members, the senators, the presidents, the voices. You'll really, truly be the adults in the room. And the world will be much better for it. And the future is scary because the president's terrifying. Right? I mean, here are young people in New York have come of age in the time of Hurricane Sandy, where New Yorkers woke up to the realities of climate change. Anyone who comes from Queens, where I hail from, we got some Queens in the house, knows that we dealt with the Rockaways and Long Island City and Howard Beach, communities who are still imperiled by climate change and will continue to be. Our summers continue to get hotter. It was the hottest July on record of recorded human history, which means more people are going to the hospital with heat-related illness and respiratory illness, because our bodies were not meant to deal with that kind of heat. And part of our, the JFK Airport, where many people arrive today, possibly, could be underwater by 2100. On top of that, we have a federal government who, I can kindly say, lacks leadership, but I could say a lot more things in a bunch of languages. but they're struggling. We seem to, because their lack of ability to recognize the truth, we struggle every day. In my community, we have power plants that are placed next to residents of public housing. Queensbridge Houses, the largest public housing in the country, sits in the shadow of the Ravenswood power plant. And thus, the higher than the average borough asthma rates also reside at the Queensbridge Houses, the Ravenswood Houses, and the Astoria houses. And the children there go to the hospital more for ER visits and hospitalizations because their lungs just can't take it. And all I can say is we're sorry. I want to apologize for those leaders who don't get it. And I know we haven't done enough yet. There's so much more that we need to do, so much more that we have to fight for. And every day I know that it's not enough. The council declared a climate emergency this past June. And since the White House won't act, it's on us. It's on the cities. It's on our states to do the right thing. Many of you already know that. You're out there every day. You're sitting in front of the United Nations, making sure we understand. And from that, I know that's why we fought so hard to pass the Climate Mobilization Act earlier this year. And this is the largest emissions reduction policy, not just in New York City history, but any city, anywhere. And we took about 50,000 buildings were regulated. Out of a building stock of 1.1 million in New York City, we regulated 50,000 buildings. But those 50,000 buildings accounted for 30% of New York City's overall emissions. That is a staggering number. So when people ask me, why did you start with these buildings? Well, that's where the emissions were, right? And special interests fought us, tooth and nail. Big real estate wanted to write the bill. And all of you stood with us to say no. Because it was time to disrupt your balance sheet because you've been disrupting our lives for too long. You know, our speakers saw this, our legislators, we passed it 45-2. But we know this is just the first step. We know that we're not done. We can't be done. We can't sit back. Because we know the future, despite passage of this bill, is still uncertain. That's why we need to keep going. This is our first step, not our last step, here in New York City. I represent a part of Western Queens known as Asthma Alley. As I talked about over 20 years ago, during the roving blackouts of Enron, in the name of reliability, here in New York State, they sited 11 power plants, two of them next to this Queensbridge houses, all of them in environmental justice neighborhoods, without an environmental impact statement, and told the residents of our communities that we need this to keep the lights on in New York City, but don't worry, they'll only be on for 3 years. Well, 18 years later, those power plants are now old enough to vote. And every day they are a reminder of a lie that continues to pump fossil fuels into communities of color and low-income communities. It is time to shut those plants down. And I believe New York City's next step is as we move to close Rikers Island. Right? All of us in this room understand the ethical, moral reasoning for closing of Rikers Island. But the choice we make next there on that island can have a profound impact on the future of New York City. Judge Lippman has called, rightfully, Rikers Island, a stain on the history of New York City. We have an opportunity to make it an emblem for a renewable energy future. The Renewable Rikers Act would transfer ownership of the island to the Department of Environmental Protection. We'd put solar power, anaerobic digestion, wind power onto Rikers Island, enough to close every one of those peaker plants that we talked about earlier. And the doctor just talked about our waters. Last year, just in Flushing Bay, Flushing Creek alone, 5 billion, that's what it'd be, 5 billion gallons of sewage seeped into Flushing Bay, Flushing Creek. That's our waste, human waste, every day. Every time it rains, and tonight's supposed to be a pretty serious thunderstorm, more than 1/10 of an inch releases sewage into our waterways here in New York City. If we build a wastewater treatment plant there on Rikers Island as well, it would be enough to stop billions of gallons of sewage from entering our waterways every single year. And I'm proud to be the lead sponsor of these bills. And I'm also proud to stand against big real estate once again. Who I'm sure sees a gated community in close proximity to their helicopters at LaGuardia Airport to be able to Uber helicopter to the Hamptons. That's not gonna happen. We need to continue to innovate. We need to find new pathways of resiliency and sustainability by getting rid of old infrastructure. We need to focus on how we can bring life to our waterways. So our job is just beginning to get cleaner. The air will only become thicker from extreme heat, so we have to prevent toxins from making them there. We have to invest in our schools. I was so proud today, our first school in our district that we funded a few years ago, 516 solar panels on PS 171 in Queens. Only a few blocks from the Astoria houses, Ravenswood houses, and Queensbridge houses. And those young people there, it's half of the energy from that school will come from those solar panels. 50 metric tons of carbon will no longer get into the air. And every day there'll be a panel in the school that says, here's how much renewable energy is created. Here's how much fossil fuels we aren't burning. Here's how much greenhouse gases we're averting. So every day, not just putting the solar panels on top of the schools, but integrating it into the educational curriculum of our students. So they're going to be the leaders. You already are our leaders. We thank you for the work that you do. New York City is committed to fighting climate change. We're committed to working for that future you talked about. We're not done here in the city of New York, and we will continue to be fighting for good laws and good policy and making the smart investments to make this city, this state, and this world brighter, greener, and safer. Thank you to New Yorkers Society for Ethical Culture for having me here this evening. Thank you so much.
And now, to conclude our evening, our final speaker and sponsor of tonight's event is a remarkable individual. Henk Rogers is responsible for a breakthrough in the computer game industry. He designed and developed the first computer role-playing game in Japan. He went to the Soviet Union and brought Tetris to Game Boy and the world in 1989. Today, he is one of the world's leading advocates and activists for reducing and eventually eliminating humankind's dependence on fossil fuels. He is the founder, visionary, and chairman of the board at Blue Planet Foundation, whose tireless efforts helped pave the way for Hawaii to enact a policy that calls for electric utilities throughout the state to rely on 100% renewable energy by 2045. Henk Rogers is also an amazing adult ally and adult leader. His newest initiative, Blue Planet Alliance, takes a mandate-first approach to initiate global climate action. The Alliance aims to create measurable and scalable results among individuals, organizations, cities, states, countries, and eventually the world. Take a look at a glimpse of his work.
Hawaii is our home. But our home is changing.
Breaking news on Kauai tonight. Devastating flooding.
Widespread damage.
Homes on the verge of collapsing.
The world is changing.
The largest wildfires in the state of California.
Tonight, the rain is over, but the disaster is not.
I worry sometimes when I think about my future. What will it be like when I grow up? Would it be like what my parents remember? Climate change scares me. But we know that it doesn't have to be this way. We can change. That's why I'm grateful for Blue Planet Foundation. For the past 10 years, Blue Planet has been leading the way for clean energy. They think if we can do it in Hawaii, we can show the entire world what a clean energy future looks like. They brought together hundreds of students just like me to be a part of the change. Join their families and neighbors to draw the line on climate change.
Our voices really matter, and us being here today is showing something and showcasing to the world that we really care about this issue and we want to take a stand.
And in 2015, their efforts paid off when Hawaii passed our country's first 100% renewable energy law. It's nice to know when I grow up, all our energy will come from clean sources.
Please welcome the sponsor of tonight's event, Henk Rogers.
Thank you to everyone for being here tonight. Blue Planet is so proud to be a sponsor of this event. That's the written part of my speech. I live in Hawaii. But I'm from New York, by the way. We're talking about Queens. I went to Our Lady of Sorrows in Corona. Anybody here from Queens? I also went to high school in Manhattan. I went to Stuyvesant High School. Anybody here from Stuyvesant? And when I was 17 years old, I belonged to an organization, and we actually met in this very building downstairs. It was called the National Ethical Youth Organization. And that's, maybe I was there to chase girls, but... Anyway, I live in Hawaii and formed a foundation to end the use of carbon-based fuel. And this came at the end of life-changing, maybe it was a life-ending experience. Found myself in an ambulance with 100% blockage of the Widowmaker. That's the heart, the biggest artery in your heart. I had just sold my company, and I'm looking at the ceiling. I said, you got to be kidding me. I haven't spent any of the money yet. Now, the second thing I said to myself was, no, I'm not going. I still have stuff to do. And in the recovery room, I got to think about what did I mean by stuff. And I actually played it forward, like, what if I actually died when I'm 90 or 100, whatever it is, what is it that's going to piss me off if I didn't do anything about it? And the first thing, the first one came to me in the back of the newspaper. So I moved from Hawaii when I was 18, and then I went from Manhattan to the beach. lived on the beach for a year, surfing and diving. Can you imagine? That is like paradise for an 18-year-old. Well, anyway, I fell in love with the ocean, and the article said, oh, by the way, we're going to kill all the coral in the world by the end of the century. I'm going like, you idiots, do you have any idea what that means? Coral supports a quarter of the species in the ocean, first of all. And coral is the canary in the coal mine. We can actually watch the coral die, but we're not watching other things in the ocean, like plankton die. We're talking about collapsing the whole food system in the ocean. And I thought, we're not going to do that. So how are we going to stop from there? What's causing that? And what's causing that is carbon dioxide being absorbed into the ocean, causing ocean acidification. But you know what? The carbon dioxide, I actually looked it up, and it's doing a hell of a lot more than that. So my mission that I decided there, right there in the recovery room, was to end the use of carbon-based fuel. To that end, I started the Blue Planet Foundation, and you know what? When I started, I had no idea what I was doing, and yet we're on the way. We have passed, we did a bunch of things. First of all, we got children, elementary school children, to go door to door, exchanging 300,000 light bulbs. And in doing so, they would have to explain to the adults what the issue was and what the bulbs would do. So then we had junior high school. You saw that in the video. They actually drew on sidewalks where high tide would be in a 1 meter rise in sea level, which is the minimum predicted by the IPCC by the end of the century. By the way, Waikiki is underwater. I talked to the mayor. He said, what happened to my beach? And I said, your beach is going to be gone just like everybody else's beach. Get used to it. What am I going to do? He said, you're going to build a wall just like we do in Holland. I'm originally from Holland. We build walls. Anyway, this is my first mission. We have passed in Hawaii the 100% mandate. We were the first state in the country to pass a mandate, 100% renewable by 2045. The utility who fought us all the way along on this, they're the biggest and the most hated company all at once in Hawaii. They came out a couple of months later and said, hey, you know what, we figured it out, we can do this by 2040. It's like, where have you guys been? You know, and we did a back of the envelope calculation, that would save ratepayers, and there's only 1.5 million of us, if you don't count the tourists, $7 billion over the lifetime of that reduction. $7 billion. Now, Hawaii spends $5 billion a year on oil. 30% goes to jet fuel, 30% goes to ground transportation, 40% goes to making electricity. We are the mecca of renewable energy in Hawaii. We have the best solar, we have the best wind, and we have geothermal. Anybody watch the volcanoes go up? That is geothermal. We have geothermal to die for. And yet we're spending... figure it out. It's $2 billion a year on making electricity out of oil. That's insane. So anyway, we're successful in Hawaii, and then other states started copying us. And so our theory of change is if we can show people that we can do it in Hawaii, we can do it in other states. So California copied us. They also came out with a mandate for 100% by 2045. And we asked them, why did you guys pick 2045? That was a negotiation between us and the politicians. And they said, you guys did 2045. Isn't that the date? That is not the date. That is not the date. That's just an accident of we tried to get 2040 and the politicians wanted 2050 and we negotiate and we settle in the middle. But 2045 turns out to be a pretty interesting date because 2045... my son tells me, is the 100th anniversary of the United Nations. Yeah. And what is the result of 100 years of the United Nations going to be? I think that it's going to be that we are going to fix everything. And the reason I came to this conclusion is I started trying to organize NGOs, nonprofits, that are all on the same kind of warpath. And I asked all of them, so what is it that concerns you the most? You know, this is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to get 100% by 2045, and I got for renewable energy. And there's two things that I got from other people, and one was, you know what, there are other problems besides renewable energy. It's not the only thing. And so here we are at Drawdown. There are 100 things that we have to fix, and we have to fix all of them. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is, and I get this from young people, is like, what are you talking about? 2045? That's way too far in the future. We need to fix this. We need to fix this now. Well, the net of the 2045, it's not so bad, because everybody in Hawaii now went from thinking that everything was going to stay the way it was to now everybody believes that we're going to go 100%. And the net of that is that we're now able to create new legislation. The new legislation says the electric company makes more money the quicker they switch to renewables. Whoa. And the result of that is that a month ago, the electric company released an RFP, that's a request for proposal, for 900 megawatts of renewable energy. That is half of Hawaii. So we are going to get there, and we're going to get there much faster than 2045, but 2045, we had to use that number. I just want to end, you know, like, this is an existential threat. Everybody knows it. And the last time we had the existential threat in most of our minds was World War II. In World War II, we went from biplanes to jet planes. We invented sonar, we invented radar, we invented missiles and cruise missiles, and we invented the goddamn atom bomb. And this is using 1940s technology. This is the 21st century. This is 2019, for Christ's sakes. We should be able to do this in 5 years if we want to. All I'm asking of all of you who are here tonight is please want to. Want to more than anything else that you've ever wanted before, and we can do this. Thanks again for everyone for being here, for joining us on live stream, to our amazing presenters, and to everyone who participated behind the scenes. This includes our evening. Thank you very much.